this video, we're going to work with the first two countability axioms. As always, remember that if you want to support the channel, you can do so in many different ways. You can either donate or become a member on Ko-fi. If you become a member, you get access to exclusive content. If in addition to that content, you want to get merchandising, then you can join us on Patreon. That way you can get stickers, t-shirts, mugs, hoodies, and many more things. But if all you want is the mathematics merchandise, then you can check out our online store to buy those things directly. So let's start with the video. We're going to talk about the countability axioms. The countability axioms are basically definitions for particular spaces. So in the case where our topological space has a countable basis at each of its points, then we say that that space is first countable. So let's see what this means. Remember that we're working with a topological space, let's call it x, tau x. And so for the space to have a countable basis at each of its points means that whenever we take an element in the space, there exists a countable basis B. So B is only going to be a collection of subsets of the space for which every time we take an element in the topology that contains our element x. So whenever we take just any neighborhood of this element x, there exists some set B in these spaces such that x is an element in B and B is a subset of U. This collection B is a countable basis, but it's local to the point x. So if we take another point x, then there will be another basis B for that point. And the first example of spaces that satisfy this condition are metric spaces. If we have x, let's say with a metric, it could be a metrizable space. So x with a topology that is induced by a metric, then x, let's say it's first countable. And this is very easy to check, because if we take x in our space, then we can define the collection B as the set of all the balls centered at x and with radius 1 over n for n, any natural number. So every metric space is first countable. Let's now see the second condition. We say that a topological space is second countable if it has a countable basis. So now metric spaces are not necessarily second countable, but there is one specific metric space that is. If we take the real numbers with the usual distance, then it is second countable, because all we're going to do is take a basis of all the balls centered at some element x, we'll say what x is now, and with radius 1 over n, where x is a rational number and then a natural number. So what we do is we only focus on those numbers that are rationals, and then we create the basis with the usual radius 1 over n. So obviously this is a countable set, and it is not hard, but I will leave it for you as an exercise to see that this set B is a basis. Second countability is a very important property, and it will be essential when we prove Urysohn's metrization theorem that gives us the conditions that a topological space has to satisfy to guarantee that that space is also metrizable. Urysohn's metrization theorem is one of the most important theorems in topology, and because of that, it would be important for us to understand second countability very well. So let's go ahead and see one of the properties that second countability gives us. If we have a second countable space and a discrete subset of the space, then we are certain that that set will be countable. The proof is not very hard, because if x is second countable, then we can take B to be a countable basis for x. And so if A is discrete, then that means that for each element in A, there exists an open set U in the topology such that the intersection of U with A is only the element A itself. But because B is a basis for the topology, then what we know is that this same condition will be satisfied for the elements in the basis. So, given A in A, we know that there exists some set B, let's call it B sub A, in the basis, such that the intersection of this set with A gives us only the element A. And so we have this mapping, the mapping that takes every element in A and maps it to the set BA. Well, let's see that this mapping is injective. For this, let's take A and B, two elements in A that are different. And let's see that the images through this function of these two elements are also different. Well, this function maps A to BA and B to BB, where BA and BB are such that BA intersection A gives us the element A, and BB intersection A is only the element B. So these two things imply that B is not an element in BA, and A is not an element in BB, because if they were, then this intersection should notice, because A and B are both elements in A. And so from this, we know that BA has to be different than BB. And with this, we know that this mapping is injective. But now, these elements BA were taken in the basis. And this basis is countable. So I can only take a countable amount of these elements BA. And again, because the mapping is injective, that forces A to have only a countable number of elements. So from knowing that this mapping is injective, then we know that A is countable. Well, let's now see an example of this theorem working. Or actually an example of when this theorem doesn't work. Let's consider R omega with a uniform topology. Remember that the uniform topology was metrizable. And if it's metrizable, we know that it satisfies the first countability axiom. And trivially, this second axiom implies the first one, because if it has a countable basis, then in particular it will have a countable basis at each element. So we obviously get from this that the second countability implies the first one. And now the question is the reverse implication valid? And we will see with this example that it's not. So let's go back. We have R omega with the uniform topology. We know that it's first countable, and the idea will be to see that it's not second countable. And the way to see that it's not second countable is using this theorem. We know that if it was second countable and I have a discrete set, then the discrete set would be countable. So what if I find a discrete set that is not countable? Then that would mean that R space is not second countable. And for this, let's consider A, the sets of sequences in the space that are only formed by zeros and ones. Now, if we grab two elements in A, X and Y, then these elements will be sequences that are formed by zeros and ones. So let's suppose first that they are different. Then we can calculate the distance between X and Y. But this distance, remember, was the supremum of the bounded distances between the coordinates. If X is different than Y, then they're different in at least one coordinate. And that would imply that in that coordinate, one of the elements is going to have zero, and the other one is going to have one. So then these distances are always one for distinct elements, and obviously zero if X was equal to Y. And this means that every point in A is isolated, and so A is discrete. But now A is obviously uncountable, because we actually know that we can find the function from the sequences formed by zeros and ones onto the interval 0, 1. So we found a discrete set that is uncountable. This implies, like I said before, that our space, our omega, with the uniform topology, is not second countable. And then our omega with a uniform topology is a first countable space that is not second countable. This shows us that first countable does not imply second countable. We will continue learning about these axioms in the following videos.